Father, we thank you so much for the day. We thank you so much for the opportunity that you've given us to gather, to honor you, to love you, to worship you. Father, we just pray that this morning everything we do is pleasing in your sight, that we are just here to honor and love you. Father, take this service as our gift to you this morning and have it with us. We pray this in your Son's name.
Please
Thank you. through my travels this week, I mean, with customers and clients and whatever, and I see a fear, like, it's just a fear on their face, their words, their actions, just a fear. And I thought to myself, you know, I tell them, I said, you don't have to fear, you have to just trust in the Lord. So it gave me a little way to prophesy this week. You know, I'm doing that. But we as children of God, we're not supposed to have no spirit of fear. We have a spirit of love, compassion, understanding, forgiveness. You know, and all that is wrapped up in this because of being children of God. So this morning, I thought to myself, what do I say at community meditation? I didn't know I was at a loss anyway. But something on my keychain reminded me. This morning I'm going to share Psalm 91. It's called Safety Abiding in the Presence of God. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but those shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, and the young lion and the serpent shall trample underfoot. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore I will deliver Him. I will set Him on high because He has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. That right there gives us hope. As the children of God, we trust in our Lord.
Let's pray. Father God, we are so grateful that You loved us so much that You would send Jesus to save us from our sins, to redeem us back to You, to present us to You holy and perfect because of the blood that You sacrificed, where He has washed us white as snow and cleansed us of our sins. We come now to remember Him and the great sacrifice which He gave for us. His great love for us, which drove Him to the cross so that He might redeem us to You, Father. As we drink of the eat of the bread, help us to remember Jesus' body as He came here and became a man, giving up His place in heaven to share with us the love of God the Father, to show us how much He loves us and cares for us, and how He had set this plan in motion to redeem us back to Himself. We drink from the cup in which the fruit of the vine represents His blood. For we do not want to forget what a great sacrifice was paid for our sins. The One who was sinless took on our sins so that we would not have to bear the burden of Him. But He bore them for us. Help us never forget this great gift and this great love which Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and God the Father has for us. Help us to remember these things as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For it's in Jesus' blessed and holy name we pray. Amen.
so sweet to trust in Jesus, but to faith in and in His Word, just to rest upon His promise, and to know the Savior.
By name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, Verily, truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolves attack the flock and scatter it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I may lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and the authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. The Jews who heard these words were again divided. Many of them said, "He is a demon possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him?" But others said, "These are not the sayings of someone possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?" And so, as I was putting this together, I got thinking, gate, door. In what I do with the alligators, we come upon a lot of different gates or doors. Sometimes they let us in, sometimes they don't. You know, you have to have the code. You have to know how to get in. Something like that. So as I'm thinking about this, I start picturing all these different looking gates and doors. If you drive out in the country here off 78 and just keep going, and as you pass properties, you're going to see all different kinds of gates and doors. Some are solid wood that swing open. Some are fancy wrought iron that are made. They're just all different types. They're there to do what?
Keep
people out. They're there to protect. And so Jesus, when he used those words, "I am the gate," immediately those who were there would go back and they would understand what he was saying. He was saying, "I am the way in and the way out." Go back to the Old Testament, and you're going to find the stories of the people. It says here, Jesus said, "Mind that at his hearers were also of the Old Testament passages that spoke of the Jewish rules and rulers as good and bad shepherds, and God as the ultimate and perfect shepherd." Psalms 23, "The Lord is my shepherd." When they start off with that, what they're saying is, "The Lord is my gate. He's my entrance." We know in the New Testament, the scripture, "No one comes to the Father but by me," says Jesus. Again, "I'm the gate. I'm the way in. Nobody comes to the Father but by me." No one gets to the sheep. I'm protecting them. If you are in mine, he talks about it here in Scripture. If you know me and I know you, I mean, you can come and go as you please. Now, to get the full picture, in the Old Testament, if you watch the shepherds go, if you watch David and different things like that, if you know shepherds, they take their flocks out to the fields. And at night, they bring them back to the city and put them in what's called the city pen. Kind of interesting. There might be 4, 5, 6 different shepherds bring their sheep to that pen. When the shepherd shows up, he goes in amongst them talking, and as he walks out, those who know him walk out with him. The other shepherd's sheep stay. Interesting. If they take their sheep out and there's no local grass for them to get to, but they have to go farther out, they might pull them down into a valley of the mountains or into a cave to keep them safe. If nothing like that's around, the shepherd's job is to build a pen. And he might roll some logs up and get some bramble bushes or whatever, and he will make a pen out of those, and then the shepherd will sleep in the entrance. Literally, he is the gate. His job is to protect the sheep no matter what comes their way. How many of you are a sheep? How many of you have a shepherd? How many of you does the shepherd protect you? I mean, through faith, we're believing today the shepherd is protecting us. Please believe that. We believe that he is due this honor, and so we're here doing this, and the shepherd will protect us today. Not trying to be foolish with it, not trying to be, I mean, that's why it's such a small crowd today. You know? But we wanted to do this to get the message out. I'm going to tell you something. I tried earlier this week. I was going to video the sermon. It's hard to speak when there's nobody there. I started going and talking, and I wanted to say, "Right, Ken?"
Right.
And I got no reply. We were joking earlier, John, I said, "Well, we could do that, and we could get the little thing and get laugh tracks and different things to make it, hey, you know, and do the ring."
6,000 people in the church.
But it's, when we scan the camera to see the 6,000 here. But it's just one of those that, you know, in order to do it, you want to do it right, you want to do it. And I just didn't feel like I could do it right, just in front of a camera. I had to have a little bit of feedback, like that chuckle, or that yes, or that, you know. And I don't know if you've ever preached a sermon or taught a lesson to nobody. You know, have you ever gone to a Sunday school class and there was just the teacher? What did the teacher do? He probably didn't teach, did he? Because there was no one there to teach. In this thing here, Jesus is the shepherd, and Jesus was doing what? Taking care of his flock. Now they give the example that the city flocks come in, and the one shepherd will walk out talking, and his sheep will follow him. Notice in the scripture here, Jesus said there are other flocks, but they too will follow me. It'll become one flock, one shepherd. How will those sheep know his name? Scripture says that on the day he returns, who will know it? Everyone. Everyone. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess. I mean, it's going to be known. He is going to be known by all, even if he's not known by all now. What they don't realize is he is their shepherd. Whether they claim him or not, he is the shepherd who will take care of the flocks. So as we go through this, we've got to keep that in mind. A sheepfold is where the sheep lay for the night. We're telling you that. And where the shepherd will lay in the doorway. Now, I think I'm a shepherd. I think God made me that way. I sleep very, very lightly. A shepherd cannot sleep heavy. A shepherd has to sleep light so that if something happens, they're awake and they can take care of it. If a wolf is approaching and the sheep start making, he has to be able to wake up and do those things. I'm the type, I'm in the house and the air conditioner kicking on can wake me up. I mean, our stairs creak. Someone can step on the first stair, I'm awake. I know that they're coming up. It's just that way. And the shepherd has to be that way. The shepherd has to be alert at all times. You think Jesus is alert at all times?
Yes.
You think he knows when there's danger coming? I mean, does he know when danger's coming to your life? And the shepherd's there. The sheep are safe as long as they what? Follow the shepherd. Listen to the shepherd. It's when the sheep don't listen that it causes problems. And in the Bible, we even see where they take care of that, don't we? 100 sheep, 99 came back. What did the shepherd do? Went out to find the one, that lost sheep. You ever been lost? Ever lost your way? I mean, there are people in church that I sit down with and they say, "Oh gosh, yeah. I didn't go to church for 18 years. Went all the time growing up, when we first got married, and for 18 years we didn't go, and now we're back at it." They were lost. They thought they could do it on their own. They were sheep on their own out amongst the wolves, and finally they came to their senses, or the shepherd came and got them to bring them home. So as we look at the story today, and as we go through, I want you to pay attention to the different parts of this story, because they each play a significant part. The shepherd, the sheep, the pen. We've talked some about the shepherd, we've talked some about the sheep, us that need to follow, need to listen. The voice, the thieves, the robbers. So we know the job of the pen. And is to keep the sheep in and keep them safe. We know the job of the shepherd, the gatekeeper, is to keep them in and guard them, take care of them, to get them to where they can eat and drink and then bring them back home safely. We know the idea of the voice. You ever hear God talk to you? That voice, you know? Some people say, well, it's my conscience.
could be. What is purpose?
What part of God do you give God the power to do this? The spirit that lives in you that tries to lead and direct and guide. I mean, it's there. The shepherd is always there trying to do what he can do for us. We have to listen for that voice. The thieves and robbers. In the first century, the shepherds had to constantly watch for those who would steal the sheep. It wasn't always wolves. Sometimes it was humans who would try to steal a sheep or two. So, but they always had to watch for those who would steal them. Often this was done by getting in the sheepfold at night by some other way other than the garden door. They would try to come in and steal. A wolf might try to climb over the barrier that the shepherd had made or whatever to try and get in. The wolf will try anything to get a sheep, to get a lamb. They'll try anything. I lived in Versailles, Kentucky. I lived in a little house, and out back they had a large field, and Dwight Elam had owned it, and he had about 30 lambs. And it was amazing how I could go out there and it would do exactly as the story said. I'd walk out there and go, hey, hey, and the sheep would go, whew. And Dwight says, go feed them. I can't feed them, they won't come anywhere near me. He goes, oh gosh, he walks up and he goes, hey! I was looking. One night, all the sheep ran to me. I stood there, just walked out to see all the noise, walked out to see what was wrong. And there, and I'm thinking, what is wrong? What is it? And out in the field was a big pit bull. And the lambs knew enough, the sheep knew enough, that this could be protection. I mean, I told Dwight next day, I said, you remember what happened last night? He said, what did you do with the dog? I said, I just stood there with the sheep and the dog went off. I said, I don't know if he was after them or if he was just passing through or if he was chasing them, what he was doing, but he just seemed to leave. And he said, what happened after that? I said, oh, of course they left. You know, they didn't want to be wrong. I said, but they knew protection and security. And he said to me, someday that's going to come in handy for a sermon. Now, how he knew that, or he was going to use it, or whatever. But, you know, as I was putting this together, I thought, hey, I have a sheep story. You know? Not often have anyone else here have a sheep story? Yeah. Margaret does. What's your sheep story? Was it a good one?
The sheep wouldn't pay any attention, and you can't shoe them like you shoe cows. You have to go in and they follow.
But if they don't know you, do they follow?
They got in. They didn't follow me, but they went through the gate.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's just interesting when you watch sheep and do those things. So really interesting when you go to shear one. To shear a lamb. To take the wool off. It's one of the most, it looks like one of the most barbaric things. Man, that shearer came and he took that lamb and picked it up and put it to the ground and put his knee down on it and started just, and you're thinking, he did that lamb's haircut in like 30 seconds. Never seen anything like it? And the lambs will line up to be sheared. Why call it, they like it because they're clean. Because they're clean. That wool collects a lot of dirt, so they're clean and they can run around. And after they get sheared, boy, they just bounce around and do all their different stuff because they're clean. And when you look at that, is that what the shepherd does for us? The shepherd ever sheared you? The shepherd ever made you clean? How did you feel on that day when you first got clean? Like them sheep, bouncing around. You know, just kind of excited, kind of there. It's there. But the thieves and the robbers. Who are thieves and robbers today? What about the militant atheists that fight against everything the church is about? Who try to get the sheep away from the shepherd? Some might say the government today, as they take God out of schools and God out of different things and doing different things, might be. I mean, there are all different kinds of thieves. Who's the thief? Satan. And if Satan can take control, if he can take, get his hands on that lamb, he'll do whatever he can to get him away from the master. But we can look at the story of Job. God had his lamb, Job. And he allowed the thief, Satan, to do whatever he wanted to that lamb. He could do whatever he wanted to except for kill him. And in that story, look at the things that Job went through as Satan tried his best to pull him and taunt him away. What was it in Job that kept him there? Faith. Faith. What keeps sheep in the pen? Faith that their shepherd has them guarded. What keeps you in church? What keeps you going? Your faith. What brought you here today? Faith. What carries you through tomorrow? Faith. Faith that the shepherd has it under control. And I believe he does. I believe that no matter what comes our way, I firmly believe God is in control. Amen. I've seen people coming together and gathering and doing things for people they haven't done. My mom was telling me a story about my Aunt Bert. Said one night she had knocking at her door. She answers the door. It's a lady from down the street. Hey, I'm going to the grocery store. Can I pick anything up for you? My aunt was like, well, that's strange. Why is she asking me? And then I realized, oh, I'm a senior citizen. She's coming to help me, you know. Had the neighbor down the street had ever asked her before if she could get her groceries for her? Probably not. But in this age, we're starting, you know, God can use this. God's in control. God's gathering in those that would be His. I mean, people are turning towards Him. There was a restaurant here in town. It's a little mom-and-pop restaurant. And a person went in and bought a hamburger. And the hamburger in order when he got done was $6.35. And he left a check for $10,006.35 with a note that said, make sure your employees get paid. You hear stories about that everywhere. People stepping up and doing, trying to help out. We weren't doing that before. We weren't doing those things. God knows what's going on. God will take those things and make good from them. We, His faithful, have to remain faithful. We have to keep our trust in the gatekeeper. We have to allow the shepherd to work through us to do those things. And here we're finding that there's going to be thieves. There's going to be those come. I mean, there's also the story of the 93-year-old lady who went down to Bass Pro Shop and bought a pistol. When they asked her, what are you doing with the pistol? She said, guard my stuff. Because she thought it's getting bad enough that people might come and try to steal from me. So she's going to guard her stuff. Now, I hate to be the one that comes across that house where she is scared, where she is frightened, where the shepherd's not there in her life, it doesn't seem like, and she's all frightened of these things, and she's got a gun. What if it's someone just coming to her door to see if she needs groceries, and she thinks otherwise? We don't know what's going on out there. We don't know what people think and how things are, but we know that when we have faith and we trust the shepherd, we're going to be taken care of. What do you need today? What do you need today that God can do that will give you hope in the future? What do you need today that God can do that will calm your nerves of the things going on around you. What do you need today that God can do? Hear the words? God can do. What can God do? Whatever God wants. Everything. God can do whatever God wants in this world today. Someone asked me, do you think your God could stop this virus today? I said, yep. There's got to be a reason and a purpose. There's got to be, could he do it? Could he teach the world a lesson of who he is? Absolutely. The guy asked me, what is he waiting on? I could tell by his question. Yep. My answer was very simple. You. That's why I said go. You. He said, what does that mean? I said, are you his? Are you his? I mean, this conversation took place at 8 o'clock. Wednesday? No. Thursday night? When I was down here at Longhorn, they were closing. I was trying to get meat. This conversation went on. I said, you. Are you his? He said, I don't know what that means. I said, yeah, then you're not. Do you know Jesus Christ? Have you given your life to him? Do you pray to God that this thing will end? He said, well, I don't think God hears me. What would make you think God doesn't hear you? Ken, does God hear you?
Yes.
Mark, does God hear you? Drew, does God hear you? I mean, we believe that God hears us, right? He had a belief that God doesn't. That tells you everything you need to know right there, that there's not a faith in that man. He doesn't know the gatekeeper. Because he doesn't know the gatekeeper, he's full of these questions and things and wondering and what's going on. At the end of our conversation, I told him, I said, we're meeting someday. His reply was, is that against the law? Is it against the law? What did the law say? As of today, it's not against the law. This week, they might make it against the law. What law? The temporary law. Temporary law because of this. There won't be a permanent law. They're not going to stop us from meeting. And if they say we can't meet, does that stop Glenn and Caroline from getting together, Tracy and Mike, and meeting?
Makes you an outlaw.
Makes you an outlaw. I mean, those things, you have to look at it. I mean, what does your faith tell you? Obviously, today faith tells you you're okay. Obviously, your faith tells you that you know the shepherd. And the shepherd is protecting his flock. Obviously, it tells you that the flock will be safe in him. Does it mean that none of us are going to get the virus? It means he's going to use that through us for others. It might be to pull us closer to him. Maybe we're wandering away. But you have to understand that everything works to good for God. I mean, God is God. God is going to take care of his people. Even if this is it, what if the entire world gets it? Death comes to all. Jesus will return. We'll see him all. See, I know today where I'm going. I know the gatekeeper. I know that when you read the stories, heaven has a gate. And I know that when I come to that gate, there in the Lamb's Book of Life are names. And I feel assured of this. I know the shepherd, and the shepherd knows me. And when I come to that gate, they're going to find my name. And they're going to say the phrase, enter in, thou good and faithful servant. And so today, what do I fear? today, what do I hold back? Nothing. I'm His. He's mine. The future is there. This is just part of the test. This is just part of the thing, and we've got to do it. Do you know the shepherd? Do you know the gatekeeper? Could you stand up here and assuredly with me say, I know. I know where my tomorrow is. I know where my eternity is. This life is okay, this life is good, but there is the reward. And the reward is always better than what you had before. So today, do you know the shepherd? Do you know the gatekeeper? Does the shepherd call and you know his voice and you answer? Do you follow the shepherd wherever he may lead you? Look at your life today. How well do you know the shepherd? How well does he know you? If you know the shepherd, you know the Father, because the Father is the shepherd, and the shepherd is the Father. I mean, he talks about it all here in this verse. Read this verse again when you go home, in John chapter 10. I mean, it lays it all out. And if you don't know the shepherd's name, then you won't follow. If you don't follow, where do you go? I mean, if you're not following, there's a great chance that the thief will steal you for eternity. So this morning we're going to stand and sing a hymn of invitation. It's your opportunity to look at your life, to answer the question, do I know the shepherd? Does the shepherd know me? Am I secure in the pen with him? The church, the pen. Am I secure? Do I do whatever he asks me to do? Do I go where he asks me to go? Am I assured of where my eternity will be if this is it? So take a look at yourselves. If you've never given your life before, if it's the first time, I mean, what a great time to give your life to Christ. To understand him and put the faith in him to take care of you and to lead you. Or like me this week, putting this together, I had to look and say, you know, how well do I follow the shepherd? How well do I do what he'd have me to do? Am I his and is he mine? That's the question for you this morning. If you have doubts, if you have a question about that, then you have places to grow to be his. Things to give up so that you can follow. So as we stand and as we sing, make your Wednesday meeting every week that we kind of go through and see what it is.
Either one?
Yeah, either one.